Hello everyone, I Janya Sharma welcome you all in today's session of webinar. The topic for today's talk will be automotive industry, testing and research. We all prefer using things with 0% of error, whereas we humans are nowhere perfect. Thus, this led to the inventions of machines. We all are surrounded by machines everywhere, whether we are on land, whether we are on water, or we are in the air. Companies like Airbus and Boeing have also started manufacturing aircraft, which are more and more depending upon the machines rather than being dependent upon the pilots. Now, talking about the automotive industry, it comprises of a huge number of companies and organizations involved in design, development, manufacturing, marketing, and selling of motor vehicles. It is one of the world's largest economic sector by revenue. The automotive industry began in the 1860s with hundreds of manufacturers that pioneered the horseless carriage. For many decades, the United States led the world in total automobile production. Safety and economy has always been a great challenge for the automotive industry. Well, I know you all are really curious to get a deep insight of the industry, and so am I. So, without making any delays, let me introduce you all to our today's speaker, Mr. Vikram Tandon, who will enlighten all of us with his deep knowledge in testing and research of automotive industry. Mr. Vikram Tandon is a Deputy General Manager in the Automotive Research Association of India. Presently, he is working in the area of automotive regulations and coordinating work related to formulation of various automotive industry standards and technical secretariat services. He has expertise in using computational tools and experimental methods for designing and analyzing automotive and non-automotive components. Some of the key areas of work have been designing of automotive radiator fans and silencers, analysis of end dampers, valves, head and rear lamps, and HVAC systems, analysis of truck and bus chassis for durability, analysis of strength of superstructure of a bus, experimental testing experience in the field of acoustic material characterizations, internal auditor for IOS 9001, IOS 18001 and NABL compliant. He has many more specializations to his credit. We welcome you, sir. We also welcome Dr. Harish Mittal, Principal BMIET, Dr. Abhinav Juneja, Associate Director BMIET, Dr. Vishal Jain, Dean Academics BMIET, and all our fellow teachers and students. Now, I would like to request Mr. Vikram to please take over.
Hi, can you share us my screen now? Good afternoon, everyone. I hope my screen is visible to everybody. Vishal, could you just confirm, please?
Yes, Abhi, not yet.
Let me know. I'll start.
Yes. Please share it. Yes, Vikram.
Okay, great. So, thank you, Janya, for the kind introduction, and I welcome school principal, sorry, college principal, Dr. Mittal, and it's all because of Dr. Vishal Jain that I am here. Though I avoid public speaking, but I could not say no to him. So, welcome to webinar on automotive industry testing and research. So I forgot to add a word, introduction, because if I start speaking on testing and research, that itself is a course in itself. So it's just an introduction to testing and research in the automotive industry. So I'll take you through that. So we'll be spending almost an hour together. So I'll just brief you the contents of the presentation. First, I'll be talking about ARAI, that is Automotive Research Association of India, the organization to which I belong to. Then I'll be speaking about acts, rules and standards, the basis on which the testing and research is happening in automotive industry. I'll be sharing some statistics with you. And then speaking on testing and research, and we'll be taking a few questions about ARAI. ARAI actually is a premier institute. It was established in year 1966. And the basic purpose of establishing ARAI was to have a common R&D center for the automotive industry in India. It has grown over the years, and we recently celebrated our 50 years of existence. Today, we are a human resource of around 800 people, more than 800, in fact, and we are accredited to different standards, quality standards. We have three different offices. First office is in the heart of the city of Pune. That's our corporate office. It also has many testing centers, testing departments. As we know, we have to grow in time. So ARAI expanded its functions and established another center. And that center is called Homologation and Technology Center. That's in a place called Pune, just outside Pune. And we have a division called Forging Industry Division, as well as ARAI Academy. That is also in Pune. In ARAI, we have different laboratories related to powertrain testing, emissions, passive safety, homologation, vehicle evaluation, automotive electronics, and all that you can think of that goes in automobile. Plus, we have Forging Industry Division, as I told you. So this division was established to assist the forging industry, which is nearby Pune. And of course, we have an office in Chennai. Our member companies include almost all automotive manufacturers that are here in India. So these are our member companies. Since ARAI is an association, so these are not just our customers, but our members as well. So you name any automotive manufacturer or for that enough, or an automotive component manufacturer, they are part of ARAI. I was a bit confused whether to show facilities in the start or at the end after viewing some of the videos so that you could appreciate more. But then I'll go ahead with showing the facilities first. And maybe once we have reviewed some of the videos that I'll be showing you in the next few slides, so you'll be able to appreciate the kind of infrastructure that is available in India to test an automobile. First, talking about passive safety. So we have facilities such as, you know, to test for pedestrian safety, testing cars in a full frontal or an offset frontal crash. Then we have facilities to test the vehicle in lateral crash. And then, of course, we test the buses as well as for establishing their structural compatibility, integrity. Then we have powertrain and emissions lab, where we test the engines, the vehicle on a whole, and in different environments. Fatigue testing, that is where it comes into play when we are doing development work and you want to do accelerated research on your vehicle. You don't want to run your vehicle on the road for long hours and you want to develop your products in a very short time. So that is where this type of testing comes into play. And there are a lot of components that go into making a vehicle. Complete vehicle. And for all those components, you require lots of testing, and those testing facilities are available at ARAI. I am told today that not only mechanical engineers, but we have electrical electronics engineer as well joining our webinar. So they would be interested that today's automobile is a mix of everything. I mean, you have mechanical, you have electronics, you have electrics. Everything goes into making an automobile today. And even for electronics, testing of lot of electronics components that go into making a vehicle today, we have to do extensive testing for those. So those facilities are available at ARA. And of course, electric mobility is getting a lot of popularity nowadays. So all those facilities are also available at ARA. Then of course, you have to test the final product on the road. So you have a lot of vehicle evaluation facilities. Then coming to NVH and CAE. So NVH is nothing but noise, vibration and harshness. In today's world, NVH is a topic of research, and CAE supports the research activities. So we have all those facilities available in ARA. So I'll be touching upon all these items in detail in my later slides. And then of course, material is the basics of everything, be it an automobile or any product that you find, and you need to have a good facilities for research as well as testing the materials. So ARA is authorized by central government to test the vehicles that are registered in India. So I'll just give you a brief that before a vehicle is allowed to be sold in India, those are required to be tested. Those tests are done as per some rules and regulations. Those are set up by the central government. And only a certain agencies in India are allowed to give those certificates with which a manufacturer can go to an RTO to get his vehicle registered. So ARA is a certified agency. And of course, ARA is certified by various quality agencies, and especially the NABL. We have provisions for testing full vehicle, either it is two-wheeler, three-wheeler, passenger cars, commercial vehicles, buses, tractors, electric vehicles, normal engines, alternate fuel engines. And of course, other than automobiles, we also test gensets. You would have find that testing of PUC is mandatory for all kinds of vehicle. And probably you would be getting your vehicles PUC tested every 6 months. So all those equipments that you find on road, so those are to be type approved by ARAI. Then of course, bus body construction, I have already mentioned. And we test for the e-markings as well. ARAI is now not a national body, so it has cooperation with other countries as well. So the certificate issued by ARAI are accepted in Singapore, as well as we have tie-ups with agencies in South Africa, Australia, and Brazil. ARAI has offices in Korea and China to support the automotive manufacturers. Those are there in Korea and China, and they have a plant in India as well. We have collaboration with the EU countries. Also, countries like Netherlands, so there the testing agencies have approved ARAI to test products on their behalf. And of course, we have relationship with Australia and Japan. So ARAI has gained name for itself, not only as a national testing institute, research institute, but as an international body as well, supporting automotive manufacturers around the world. So considering that ARAI has been in business for last 50 years, so obviously the hard work pays off in terms of some of the rewards. And some of the prestigious awards that we got recently include the Golden Peacock Award for the environment management. And of course, there are various other awards. And recently, our director, last director, in fact, Mrs. Rashmi Udhavareshe, got the Nari Shakti Award from the President of India. So I can see some of the lady engineers also joining our webinar today. So you should be encouraged that automotive industry gives equal opportunity to the lady engineers as well. And our last director was a lady, and who got such a prestigious award from the government of India. Starting from 1966 till today, so we started as a test lab in the initial years. Obviously, it was a facility establishment through the help of government of India. Then as we went ahead, we were more involved with testing of products. Then, of course, as you do more and more tests, you develop your technology, you have more and more expertise, and then that expertise is put to use for basic research, which helps the industry in India. The service portfolio of ARAI includes certification and homologation. So that is the main business of ARAI today. And secondly is research. It is assisting Government of India in formulation of various standards, as well as assisting government in policy making. Then we provide a lot of consulting and services. And then, of course, last but not the least, education and training. So let's talk about acts, rules, and standards. So that's where my actual presentation now starts. So let's first see the hierarchy of acts, rules, and standards. At the bottom of the pyramid, we have standards. So to test any product, we should have a standard. Those standards are established in India. And while establishing those standards, we take a reference from all around the globe, and we follow the best practices that are available in the world. So these standards provide the approval procedures, test standards, and the standards that are available in India are either called AIS standards or IS standards. And just to expand them, it is automotive industry standards or Indian standards. Moving up the pyramid, we have rules. So in India, we call them Central Motor Vehicles Rules. So these standards are governed by these rules. So all automotive vehicles that are run in India, so those are approved as per these rules. And in fact, the vehicles running on road, they have to follow certain rules. So these are all covered under Central Motor Vehicles. And on top of the pyramid, we have the Motor Vehicles Act. So this act provides the, you know, the power to make rules. And these rules are then framed by the Government of India through Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. And those rules mention these standards. So this is the hierarchy of the acts, rules, and standards that are available in the country today. So what are the driving forces behind establishing any rule or a standard? First and foremost is a political. So as you would have seen that we have many international agreements, our government is continuously engaging with different countries throughout the year and throughout the decades. So and through these political engagements, so we sign various agreements between countries. And when we sign these agreements, so these have a lot of, you know, development in each and every area of industry, and that includes automotive as well. And some of these agreements drive the rules and standards making in India. Then an important factor is economics, fuel import bill, road accidents. So these are the major areas which play an important role in making these rules and standards. And of course, social, which involves providing affordable rural transport and again road accidents. Then of course, as you know, technology keeps on advancing, and each and every day we hear about, you know, different types of product that are coming in the market, and every time, you know, we have advancements in the technology. So obviously with these advancements, the standards have to be reviewed, have to be framed afresh. So this is again an important driving force. Then of course you have legal, so you have court directives. Sometimes court takes things in their hand and asks government to, you know, make certain rules and regulations. And then of course there are environmental issues. So we see a lot of, you know, debate going on that there are automobile is a major pollutant, and therefore you should have strict norms for emissions in the country. So these sort of things, you know, they drive the rules and standard formulation in the country. What are the key areas around which the national policies are framed? First is emissions. So recently, I'm sure you would have been listening to an agreement called Paris Agreement. There, the target is to limit temperature, limit and greenhouse gases. And then of course, to be self-reliant on energy, India spends a lot of money in importing crude oil from countries abroad, and that takes away a lot of our foreign reserves. Then, of course, green mobility. So India has come up with a scheme called Faster Adoption of Manufacturing of Electric Vehicles. That's the FAME scheme that is to promote a lot of domestic Indian manufacturers to manufacture electric vehicles in India and provide a safer as well as cleaner mobility in India. And of course, there is a Brasilia declaration, and the target of that declaration is to reduce the fatalities by half. The fatalities were to be reduced by half in the year 2020. But as you will come to know through my statistics that I'll be showing you, that we are far away from that target, and we have all to play an important role to make that a success. So these are some of the key areas which drive our national policies. India's climate and energy policies. So India is the fourth largest GHG, greenhouse gas emitter in the world, accounting for around 5.8% of global emissions. That's too big a number. And therefore, a government took an initiative and signed the Paris Climate Agreement. And there it was agreed to, you know, to reduce the temperature, to limit the temperature increase by 1.5 degrees centigrade. And then, of course, when we sign an agreement, so you have to follow certain guidelines. And there were some major drives under that agreement. And of course, under these drives, then you have to see various regulations that drive not only the automotive industry, but the other associated industries as well. And similarly, it had an effect on the automotive industry in India. And therefore, vehicle fuel efficiency standards were introduced in India in the year April 2017 for passenger cars and for heavy vehicles from April 2018. So vehicles were supposed to, you know, give a certain amount of mileage to be fuel efficient and not just be fuel guzzlers, as they are popularly called. And as I talked about Brasilia declaration, so India committed that India will reduce its road accident fatalities by 50% by the year 2020. And under that declaration, so the objective was to encourage the vehicle and safety equipment industries to further develop their products in such a way that this target is met. Then reaffirming the role and importance of the United Nations legal instrument on road safety. The United Nations is very serious about reducing the road fatalities, and they work extensively to bring out, you know, safety standards, emission standards, which provide safer and cleaner vehicles on road. And then developing comprehensive legislation on key risk factors. And of course, there is a term called Decade of Action for Road Safety that was from 2011 to 2020. And there were a lot of actions that were identified to meet this target. So then India took it upon themselves to meet this target and come up with a lot of regulations which would help India to reduce the road fatalities. So therefore, in recent times, we came up with regulations related to seat belts, airbags, active safety systems, ABS and ESC. I'll come to details about all these in my later slides. Then, of course, improving the professional drivers' conditions, and then develop national and regional and global targets to reduce road traffic crashes and fatalities. So this involves involvement of all stakeholders, not just of the government or of the automotive industry. So when talking about that Brasilia declaration, there was a paper that came out, and that is a WHO discussion paper. So in that, they came out with a goal that there's the traffic deaths and injuries should be reduced by 50% by year 2020. And in doing so, minimum targets were set for all the automotive manufacturers around the globe that so and so minimum regulation should be available in all vehicles that are manufactured in the countries. Accordingly, These are some of the key parameters that were identified. These include frontal impact protection, side impact protection, electronic stability control, pedestrian safety, seatbelt regulations, child restraint regulations, and motorcycle anti-lock braking system. And you will appreciate the fact that Government of India not only signed the agreement in showing their commitment to reduce the fatalities, but in recent times in India, all these regulations have been mandated. I'll come to the details in my later. So in India, we have a very extensive setup to establish the standards. So the nodal agency in India is Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. And under Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, there are two important committees known as Central Motor Vehicle Rules Technical Standing Committee, and one is Standing Committee on Emissions. These two committees are supported by a technical standard. Automotive Industry Standards Committee formulates all the AI standards that are developed in India. And this AIC committee is chaired by Director ARA. So once these standards are established, so they are put up to various higher level committees. They discuss these, they adopt these standards, and then they are put up to the ministry for finally implementing them on road. So you would notice that each year, maybe each year or every 2 years, you find a lot of changes in our automobiles that are introduced in India. So earlier we had no mandatory requirements for airbag, but today we have. So those requirements all come through these standards. So standards are established, they are put up to the ministry, and then ministry take a call to establish these standards and make them mandatory for all the manufacturers. And then we have another route to establish standards, that is through Ministry of Commerce. Ministry of Commerce establishes IA standards through a Bureau of Indian Standards. These standards too are discussed by MoRTH, and if needed, they are notified under Central Motor Vehicle Rules. As I mentioned earlier, that United Nations play an important role while establishing safety standards, which are followed throughout the world. In India, though we have our own standard, those are automotive industry standards or industry standard, but most of our standards are derived from the regulations that are formulated by under UNEC. There is a body under UNEC called WP29. WP means nothing but Working Party. That is Working Party 29, and that establishes various automotive related regulations, whether it is related to vehicle safety or environment. And those regulations are then followed by various countries. Those are signatory to various agreements. Under WP29, there are two major agreements. One is 1958 and another is 1998. First is 1958 agreement. Under 1958 agreement, they formulate standards called UN regulations. And under 1998, they formulate standards called UN Global Technical Regulations. And India is a signatory 1998 agreement, under which global technical regulations are formulated. As a signatory body, we are bound to follow these regulations in our country. India is extensively contributing, formulating international standard as well by sharing their experience on board. So under WP29, so there are six major groups. Those work in different areas of automotive. First is, if I talk about general safety, then another is lighting and light signaling devices. Then there is noise. There is a group working on autonomous and automated vehicles. Then again, there's a group working on pollution and energy. And last and not the least is a group on working on passive safety. So they have divided their work in six different domains. And there are various technical experts from around the globe, those who actively participate in these six groups. And they come up with various updated and important regulations which regulate the automotive industry all over the world. And India extensively participates in these forums. Those are held in Geneva, Switzerland. every year. Coming to safety norms that have been established in India over the years. So from year 2000 onwards till year 2020, so we have seen progression of automotive industry. Like people of my age would remember that earlier we used to have just a car called Ambassador or Fiat Premier Padmini, and the quality of those products and the comfort of those products to the safety and comfort of the vehicles those are available today. Those have seen extensive change over the years, and it has come because of these regulations that have been introduced over the years. It started with brakes regulations, steering in year 2000. Then, of course, regulation with respect to noise and retro reflectors, safety of battery operated vehicles in year 2005 and 10. Then came some standards on spray suppression, traction batteries in year 2010 and 15. Then in 2015 and 20, that has been an important, you know, phase in Indian automotive industry, where India introduced extensive crash norms, airbags and CRS, or CRS means nothing but child restraint systems, norms related to speed and seatbelt alert, pedestrian safety, and whole lot of various safety norms that were introduced in that phase. And of course, now moving forward, we are coming up with another set of safety norms, including electronic stability control, and then safety norms for all types of construction equipment vehicles, those are seen on road. And then of course, standards are being formulated for technologies such as advanced emergency braking system, where the braking happens because of the mechanics that is available in the vehicle itself and not by the driver. That is, a lot of electronics is going on in the today's vehicle, you know, to enhance the safety of the vehicle. Not just for safety of the regular vehicles that are available on road, India did a lot of work and came up with standards for special purpose vehicles, such as ambulance, double-deck buses, school buses, sleeper coaches, and motor caravan. So in my earlier slides, I had shown that there are various social requirements while relating, deciding various rules and regulations. So these norms and regulations have come up because of that. Similarly, we have norms for emissions. So in India, we had emission norms started from year 1990. And then major change came in year 2000, where we started with BS norms, that is called Bharat Stage norms. So Bharat Stage 2 norms were introduced in year 2000. And recently in year 2020, we have introduced Bharat 6 norms. And you would appreciate the fact that India directly jumped from BS4 norms to BS6 norms. And in the countries, advanced countries like Europe, there they moved from stage to stage. They had Euro 4, Euro 5, Euro 6. But since we had, you know, signed those various international agreement and we had to meet our targets, so India skipped that Bharat stage 5 and we directly jumped to Bharat stage 6. And that involved a lot of research work, not only by automotive manufacturers, but oil refineries. And, you know, a lot of work has gone in that to bring that in reality today. And as engineers, we should appreciate that fact, the hard work that has been put up by all of the automotive engineers. Apart from regular fuels to meet the fuel requirements of India, so as I told that India wants to be self-reliant in fuel, so we have introduced various alternate fuels requirement, which includes, you know, requirement related to ethanol, methanol. And such regulations now exist in India, and it is left up to the researchers to come up with technologies which can run on these fuels. So, you know, government has already done its part to regulate all these technologies, and researchers are encouraged to work in these areas and to bring vehicles so that India becomes self-reliant as far as fuel is concerned. Let me share some important statistics with you. and why you have these acts, why you have these rules, why there is need of standards. So probably these statistics will help you appreciate all this, that work that goes behind formulating these rules and standards. Automotive industry in India. So it's a very a big industry. I mean, all major automotive manufacturers of the world are now present in India, and all the four major areas of India, that is north, east, south, and west. So in each area, we have some of these manufacturers located in the north as well as in east and south or west. And in after establishing the state of Uttaranchal, obviously some of the manufacturers established a few of their operations there also. And now, obviously, all manufacturers are now decentralizing their operations and going to different parts of India. Automotive industry accounts for 7% of country's GDP. And that's a very big contribution in the India's economy. And it plays an important role in providing a lot of manufacturing jobs, and not only just manufacturing, and now with a lot of manufacturing, and as I earlier said, like ARI, we did a lot of testing earlier, and now with all that expertise, we are moving to research. Even in the Indian automotive industry, we are doing a lot of research, and our manufacturers are now coming up with products which are equivalent or maybe in some areas advanced than those are available in the world outside. Taking example of two-wheeler industry in India, that is one of the best in the world. And recently we introduced a product called quadricycle. So for quadricycle, we introduced some of the safety norms which were not available in advanced countries, even in like Europe. So we are progressing very fast, and India is trying not only to be a manufacturing hub, but to be a design hub as well in the automotive industry. Then of course, when it comes to automobiles, so to run an automobile, you need an extensive road network. So Indian government is working extensively to lay out good roads. And India's road network as of today is 58.98. I have missed some figure here. Some lakh kilometers, and it is the second largest in the world. So this national highways accounts for 1,14,000 kilometers, which is approximately 2% of the road network in India, and rural road is around 70%. And as of 31st March 2017, India's road density is 1.80 kilometer per square kilometer, which is equivalent to advanced country like Germany. So we have done a lot as far as road development is concerned, and I am sure that in days to come, India will be as good as any developed country in the world. But with all the good things around, I mean, we have good manufacturers, we have good roads. So obviously there are concerns as well. So India ranks number one when it comes to road accident. And that's a major concern, not only of the government of India, it should be a major concern for all of us as engineers, as well as, the citizens of the country. And India accounts for almost 11% of the accidents related deaths that happen all around the world. During 2018, almost 69% of the road accidents and road accident victims were of the age of 18 to 45. Now you can imagine 18 to 45, that's a working age where most of the people either are starting to work or they are already on job, they are breadwinners for their families, and they are the main people, those who are the victims of those accidents. And that you can imagine what a great impact that leaves on the economy of the country. We talk a lot about, female riders as well as male riders. So I believe the male riders can take a note of it, that 86% of the road accident involve the male riders and just 14% involve the female riders. So as a male rider, so there is a need to be focused on our driving skills as well, and not just to blame the female gender that they drive badly. So coming to the road accident vehicle category wise, so obviously we have a large population of two-wheelers. So that's why you would see in the pie chart that a lot of two-wheelers are involved in the accidents. And then of course you have the cars, then the buses, trucks and tempos, etc. So we have a large number of two-wheeler in India, and that's because it provides a very, you know, economical ways of transportation from one place to another. And we have a very young population also that thrives on riding two-wheelers. So that's how the population is too high. And obviously when population of two-wheelers is high, so it comes in the highest category of the vehicles which we. I'm coming to this slide. So this is a very sad slide for India. So in the year 2015, we had around 5 lakh accidents in India, and almost 5 lakh people were injured, and almost 1.5 lakh people died in those accidents, and which resulted as if you divide those by hours and all. So it comes to 57 accidents and 17 deaths every hour. After the end of this webinar, almost you can say we'll be consuming an hour. So 57 accidents would have already happened and 17 deaths would have already happened in India. Thanks to this corona that less vehicles are going, probably these numbers will come down, but that's a loose statement. But however, this is a data over and above the years. Even if you see the data of 2018, though the number of accidents got reduced, the numbers came down to almost 4,60,000, but the fatalities have not reduced. And it still results to 53 accidents and 17 deaths every hour. And that's a very sad figure. And government is doing its bit, coming up with various safety regulations. The manufacturers are doing their bit in following those regulations and coming up with safer vehicles. But we as stakeholders, we as drivers, we as riders have an important role to play in meeting that target to reduce that road fatalities of 50%. So we are engineers and we can appreciate the fact that to bring a product in market, it takes a lot of effort. And when that product comes to market, we would like to meet the success that it is intended for. But if it doesn't meet that success criteria, then obviously it's a big failure. So the lot of work that has been going in to make those vehicles safer, that's not coming into realizations after seeing these figures. And it's just because that the people on road are not that vigilant enough to bring these numbers down. If we compare 2018 with 2015, the fatalities have gone up. Though road accidents and persons injured, that number has come down, but still a lot of work has to be done. So I've taken all these data from a source called Road Accidents in India. Ministry of Road Transport and Highways publishes these data every year. And as engineers, and especially those engineers, those who want to be in automotive industry, I would like you to refer Ministry of Road Transport and Highways website on continuous basis and go through these reports. There is a lot of very important data that is shared through these reports. I have just picked a very important things that I wanted to share. But other than these statistics, there are a lot of important aspects which you can go through. And probably in times to come, if these numbers do not fall, probably these reports would be part of academics also, so that people are well aware of these statistics, not only as engineers or policy makers, but as students as well, that okay, where as a country we are going and that what concerns as a country we have. When we talk of accidents, then obviously a major killer overspeed. When you drive a vehicle around roads, you would see a lot of signboards, speed thrills but kills, but not many people follow that. And 64.4% of the person killed in an accident is because of overspeeding. So that's more of an attitude problem rather than a regulation or a safe vehicle problem. And some of the key issues which can be handled by the stakeholders, those include use of mobile phones. 2.4% of the deaths that are happening in India because of road accidents is because of the use of mobile phone while riding a vehicle. Drunken driving, that accounts for 2.8% of the persons killed. 29% of the deaths can be attributed to non-use of helmets. So this point probably I would like to, you know, take a note of. Probably you are a lot of young engineers out there who are mostly, you know, driving two-wheelers nowadays. Probably would be switching to cars in future, but today you are riding two-wheelers. Please do not ride a two-wheeler without a helmet. So the death rate because of non-use of helmet is 29%. That's a significant number. And if we are able to, you know, target that, so we definitely coming close to meeting our target of reducing the death rate of by 50% as India is obligated to. Then obviously comes another safety feature, that is safety belts. 15% of the deaths are attributed to the non-use of safety belts. I use a Mercedes car, for example, and don't use a safety belt. Sorry, the Mercedes-Benz can't do anything for you, and it can be fatal for you. The point is, it's the vehicle manufacturers are doing their bit. The government is doing their bit. But as drivers, as riders, we have to do our own bit to bring these fatalities on the road to a minimum. Then what does a government do after collecting all these statistics? So government comes up with more and more norms. So with advancement in technology, we have a lot of different norms for automotive manufacturers. Like for example, recently, like I just said that no overspeeding kills. So we have a special norm that has recently come up that is called a speed alert norm. Then we have norm for safety belt reminder. In some of your cars that you would be riding today, you would have noticed that if you don't, you know, put on your safety belt, especially for the driver, you have that beep. So now that has been made mandatory. Now it's not no more just a feature that is provided by the manufacturer, but it's a mandatory feature now. Then of course, mandatory frontal impact and offset frontal impact norms were introduced by the government. Then were introduced for the pedestrian safety, that if there is an accident involving a passenger car and a pedestrian, then the pedestrian should be impacted as little as possible. So the vehicle design should be such that the pedestrian meets with less injuries. So we have norms for that. And of course, we had an important regulation called anti-lock braking systems that was introduced for various categories of vehicles. And especially for two-wheelers, we had norms for anti-lock braking systems and other norms as well. Now I move to testing and research. Why you require testing? Why you require research? Obviously, when we have seen that we have these statistics, so we have a lot of fatalities, we want to reduce those fatalities. So to reduce those fatalities, we come up with different technologies. When we come up with different technologies, so you want to test those different technologies. When you want to test those different technologies, you establish various rules and standards. And those rules and standards then assist the engineers to test the product for peripheral lines. And obviously, testing happens for two different reasons. First is to develop a product, and second is for mandatory compliance. So standards are formulated to meet a minimum set of safety standards. Okay. So they can, when you establish a standard, so it is for meeting a minimum set of requirements. You can go overboard, definitely. And that is how you have different categories of vehicle, different class of vehicle. So let's move on to testing and research. And before I go any further, so I'll just again reiterate that this is just an introduction, probably give you a feel that what sort of testing and research work is done in the automotive industry. And probably to, you know, to rekindle that spark in you, probably take automotive as your career as you go forward. So as I mentioned earlier, that you know, a lot of norms were introduced for passenger cars that included a mandatory requirement for airbags. So you would be surprised to know the fact that though there are safety requirements all over the globe, and even in India we have that requirement, but in India, we went overboard and ensured that airbags are made mandatory. Airbags are not made mandatory anywhere in the world, though it is provided by the vehicle manufacturer to meet those norms. That's a different question. But the government went forward and they have made an airbag as a mandatory feature. Presently, today, it is only for the drivers, but probably in future it might come for the co-driver as well. Then of course you have requirement for safety belt reminder. Then you would have heard of many accidents happening that the car get locked and the occupant is not able to come out of the vehicle when there is an accident or suppose there is a fire. All because of those incidents, the government took a note and, you know, the regulatory bodies and the standard making bodies were asked to come up with standards wherein, you know, you have features which allow an occupant to come outside of the vehicle if there is such an emergency. Then we have rear parking assist systems to assist the driver while taking his vehicle in reverse or during parking. So such norms have been recently mandated by the Government of India. And the vehicles which are in manufacturing since year 2019, July 2019, to be precise, you will find all these vehicles fitted with these. Then, of course, the crash standards and pedestrians. So just before showing you some of the videos of this crash testing, so I'll just show you a glimpse of what these standards are about. The first standard is on steering impact. This standard is nothing but automotive industry standard, and it has a number called AI-096. So it was notified by government long back in year 2015. And as of today, that is from 1st October 2019, all vehicles which are manufactured in India, so every vehicle has to mandatorily meet this requirement. And initially I had mentioned that even quadricycles, which is a new product in market, that also has to meet this requirement, which is not existent for quadricycle manufactured in Europe. That is how strict we are in India now to meet this safety. Then we have another stringent norm, which is even more severe than a head-on collision, that is an offset frontal collision. So as you would notice that the vehicle, you know, it collides halfway with an existing barrier. And this is considered to be even more severe than colliding head-on with a full barrier. And these tests happen at certain speeds. At full frontal, this is at 53.1 km per hour. And offset frontal, it happens at 56 km per hour. And all these Indian standards are aligned with UN regulations which are formulated under the UN. Then we have standard for, you know, testing for lateral strength of the car. And of course, we have standard for testing pedestrian safety, both for adult as well as child. So now I'll be showing you a few videos. Unfortunately, I cannot show you videos of the testing that is done by ARAI because of the, you know, confidentiality. But I will show you some of the videos which are available freely on YouTube. Probably some of you would have already seen it. But let us revisit them again as a part of our webinar. And let us see how extensively the testing is done throughout the globe. First, I will be showing you two videos in which you will be seeing a sedan as well as an SUV, wherein, you know, we'll be witnessing some of the crash tests which are conducted under a program called Euro NCAP. So Euro NCAP, just to introduce with you terminologies like NCAP. So nowadays, if you extensively go through automotive related news, you will find that Indian automobiles that are running on Indian roads, they are getting some safety ratings like 5-star, 4-star. So what are those ratings? So there is a organization called Euro NCAP program. There is a program called Global NCAP programs. So these programs are over and above the safety requirements which are to be minimum met by a vehicle manufacturer. These are over and above those minimum requirements. So these programs then evaluate a product and then give you the safety ratings. However, the tests are same, but they are done at different speeds. So just to rate the vehicle more than what is required as a minimum. So first we'll be witnessing the test conducted on a sedan. I'll just take a pause here just to show you the impact of the collision that happens on the occupant, which is sitting in the rear seat, not even in the front seat. So he is wearing a seatbelt, this dummy is wearing a seatbelt, and that is how this has been restrained. Now just imagine if there was no seatbelt, so this dummy would have flown out of the vehicle. So that is the importance of wearing a seatbelt while riding a vehicle, not just if you are sitting on the front seats, but as well if you are occupying the rears. Now, this is a pedestrian safety test. This head form, you know, symbolizes a head of the adult. So what happens? So when the vehicle crashes with a pedestrian, it falls on the bonnet of the vehicle. And when it impacts the bonnet of the vehicle, so what sort of injury does the head meet? So this is what is attained through this test. And the vehicle manufacturers today are to meet stringent requirements, you know, to provide the least injury to the pedestrian if there is an accident like this. I just noticed that we are almost at 3. So Vishal, I'll just take your input. Is it okay time-wise? I mean, probably I'll be needing another 30 minutes if it's okay. Or else I can skip a few videos. Vishal, are you there? Okay, I'll skip the similar video which was conducted on a, you know, a SUV type vehicle. So now we'll just witness another test. Earlier you saw, high class product manufactured by a very well-known automotive manufacturer, meeting all those, various safety norms. So let us now see the norms that are met even by the Indian manufacturers. And even the Indian manufacturers are doing extensive work to meet these global requirements. Not just to promote any of the manufacturer, all the automotive Indian manufacturers are meeting these regulations. Just a video that I got from the YouTube for sharing.
वही जो कार को जो भाई राजू को जाना वहां से तो कुछ बना नहीं लेकिन दो तीन जा रही नहीं
या विक्रम इज इट प्लेइंग
या इज इट इट इज आर यू नॉट एबल टू सी
आई थिंक इट इज नॉट स्ट्रीमिंग विक्रम YouTube we are not able to see your video.
Were you able to see the first video at least, the sedan one?
No, I don't think so. Nothing was live.
Oh. Are you able to see my video now?
Pardon?
At least the screen.
Screen, I can see the links of the videos are there, but the video is not streaming. They are not streaming.
I'm not sure if it's a bandwidth problem.
Maybe that it is at your end because I have just checked my bandwidth. It's perfect. Maybe it's at your end. No problem, Vikram, you carry on. You can send me the links of the videos later. I'll send to every participants later on. We can do that.
Unfortunately, these were the main contents of my presentation.
Okay. No issue, Vikram.
Okay.
Hello.
Just give me a moment.
Okay.
I have a lot of videos actually to share, and probably I thought, while watching those videos, I'll discuss various aspects of testing. Unfortunately, now these videos are not playing.
Vikram, you can open up your browser and then you can paste this link from here to your browser directly, and then you can share that. I think that would work.
Okay. You able to see now?
No, are we still not visible? Open up a new tab in the browser and then you can paste this. And you can
minimize
this current presentation.
That's what I did. Not happening for me. I'll try a different browser. Just give me a moment. If that doesn't work, then I'll continue with my presentation. and probably share you these links.
Okay, you can share us and I'll share it further.
If you give me 5 minutes, what I can do, I can have these links numbered 1, 2, 3. I'll have them in a notepad. I'll share that, and probably individual participant can play at their own end.
Okay.
And I can play at mine. Is it okay?
Yes.
Because without watching these videos, there will be no feel for this.
I think, Vikram, you can run this presentation from the bottom, that icon is there. Then I think this link would be active.
I'm doing that. I don't know why it's not working.
You run this presentation and then you can click on the link, I guess.
Anyways, I have now listed these. I am sending you a note file. Probably you can share it with participants, if you want. Is there some way I can mail you this file now?
Something, Vikram, just try that. Stop sharing once and then you can share it. Maybe the problem is resolved by that. You stop sharing once and then again try to share.
Okay, let's try again. If it works fine, or else I will move it in that. coming on screen now?
It's not working, Vikram.
Okay.
Let us carry on.
Okay, I'll do that. So, what I will do, I will just share these links with Dr. Vishal Jain, and probably he will circulate to all of you. And out of interest, you can see these files. And some of these files, you know, contains the mandatory tests which are required by the week, and some of the tests which are over and above these mandatory tests. Again, I had a video here, but I'll not go into videos. So how we test a bus now? So now, for example, for cars, you have barriers on which the cars go and impact. Bus, what we do, we have it on a platform, and that platform is a straight one earlier. It is then tilted, starts tilting till the bus gets rollover and it falls on a surface. And what we do, we at the end of the test, we measure the distance of these sections with these seats. And if we want to, you know, ensure that the occupants are safe, so there is a minimum criteria which this section has to meet, and it should not protrude inside the occupant safety area. That is the intent of this test. And the buses are also extensively tested. And since buses are very expensive and it's a big product, and however, little simpler in structure than our pedestrian cars, passenger cars. So we can have that test done through simulation also. Simulation has gained lot of significance nowadays in while providing certification also. So we can do this testing through simulations also. And similarly, for testing, you know, truck cabins. So we have simulation environment where we can test the actual test. So we have a pendulum, so that is impacted on the truck cabin to ensure that the driver inside is safe along with the co-driver. So those sorts of testings are available, and not only test, but simulation facilities are also available. Before going to breaks, so once you have seen all those videos, that probably the links that you will be getting, so you will appreciate the fact that all those facilities today are available in India, and all vehicles that are available in India to the customers, they meet those requirements. So as I mentioned earlier, that the videos, they show some of the requirements which are over and above the mandatory requirements. But obviously, some of the crash requirements are met by all the people. And of course, coming to brakes, the main function of the brakes is to slow down the vehicle. And of course, there goes some physics behind it. I'll not go into that. A major part of the brake research that went into is that the wheel, while braking, the wheel should not get locked. Once the wheel locks, so you tend to slip. So you would have noticed that in earlier two-wheelers or in the cars or in the big vehicles, whenever you have a panic braking, so you have a scenario where the vehicle slips, okay? Whether it is on a wet surface or a dry surface. So what we, as a automotive industry, did was that we introduced automatic braking systems. So I'll just try to play one video. So just let me know quickly whether it is playing or not. You are able to see or not. Dr. Jain, were you able to see that?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yes. Okay. So now I'm trying to show you that if there is no ABS, and when we apply sudden brakes, that is what we call as panic braking, then what sort of different scenarios that we observe? There is a tractor-trailer combination. You will see that the tractor has gone the other way. And here you will see the vehicle not stopping. He's trying to steer the vehicle in this direction, left, right side, but he's not able to steer the vehicle. This is what happens in the brakes if the ABS is not there. Let us review again. Without ABS and with ABS. The objective was that there is sudden obstruction in front. There is a sudden obstruction in front. The driver has to steer the vehicle and safely pass through. But unfortunately, without ABS, he is not able to do that. Now let's see what happens with ABS. So he was safely able to maneuver the vehicle through that obstruction. So that is the advantage that we got through anti-lock braking system. The wheel doesn't brake. The driver is easily able to maneuver the vehicle and avoid an accident. So that is what an advantage that as a vehicle user one is getting now with the introduction of this technology. And this has been mandated recently in all types of vehicles. Let's see another scenario. So you would have now noticed that it took such a long time for the vehicle to brake. And suppose if there was a vehicle in front, then obviously it would have met its fate. Now let's see a vehicle which is already fitted with the ABS. So what it did, it reduced the braking distance significantly. And while braking, you would observe that it doesn't allow the brakes to lock, the wheels to lock. So it just locks, it releases the pressure, the wheels move, so it doesn't skid and it stops in a straight line, as well as the stopping distance is reduced considerably. So this was a very nice video, but unfortunately not able to play. So another important system which has been introduced in India is electronic stability control systems. So probably when in future you go and buy a car, so in some of the variants you will find that the vehicle is fitted with electronic stability control. So what happens that during the curves, when you are riding fast and you are on a curve and you lose control, so these sort of systems help you, you know, to stay on the track, and these help the driver to keep the vehicle on track and avoid accidents as much as possible. Electronic stability control, as the word goes, the electronics come into picture. The driver just applies the brake and the electronics that is available in the vehicle that takes control, and it senses that, okay, whether there is an emergency situation, and it regulates the pressure on each wheel to let the vehicle be on track. That is how that artificial intelligence is coming into play while braking. So I'll share this link again with you. In ABS two-wheeler, unfortunately not able to share with you. So the new two-wheelers that are available in India today, including the scooterets like the less than 125cc, so they are either fitted with an anti-lock braking system or a feature called combined braking system. So what happens when you are having an anti-lock braking system is that the vehicle wheel doesn't get locked. You apply a panic brake. Suppose you are on a two-wheeler, you suddenly see that there is some wet surface in front or there is oil in front, and you suddenly apply brake. So what usually used to happen, that obviously you used to meet with a fall. But now with such systems, you are able to, you know, regain control quickly, and you are able to, you know, manage the vehicle quickly and avoid a fall. So that avoids accident. But obviously, the ABS is provided on a two-wheeler, but that doesn't mean that you should ride a two-wheeler fast. You should maintain the speed limit. Some work only when they are, you know, the vehicle is in a certain speed range. So all these tests are done with a certain speed range. So these vehicles are not done, you know, at 100 kilometers, 120, 140 kilometers per hour. All tests are done at a standard speed range. So that doesn't allow, you know, having, as I earlier said, that you are driving a Mercedes, but you are not putting a seat belt. So it is as dangerous as driving any other car in the market. So like ABS fitted on your two-wheeler, so you are driving very fast, which is beyond the range which vehicle can handle. So even if the vehicle is fitted with ABS, I'm sorry, it might not work. And then you cannot go and complaining that my vehicle was fitted with ABS. Okay, let's come to components now. So wheels have been a very important discovery of mankind, and it has undergone great revolution with over the years. And it's an important part of the vehicle. You can have all sorts of electronics in your vehicle. You can have a very good engine. You can have all those electronic features. But unless and until the tire is there, you cannot have the contact on the road. And if there is no contact on the road, the vehicle cannot run. So when you are talking of tires, so I showed you the brake performance. So in braking performance, tires play an important role. And not only in braking performance, but providing a good fuel efficiency, a good tire performance is mandatory. As I mentioned earlier, the government is trying very hard to meet the fuel targets of the country. And as we know that whenever you want to, you know, overcome some resistance, so there is an efficiency loss. And efficiency loss that automobile has to overcome is 42% when we talk of drag. That is because of the tires, so the aerodynamics as well as the tire friction. And when we talk of tire friction, so the main parameter that comes into play is rolling resistance. So nowadays, a lot of tire manufacturers are working on providing low rolling resistance tires. And you have systems such as tire pressure monitoring systems fitted on the vehicle, which give you live information about the tire pressure in your so that you are well aware that, okay, if my tire pressure is going down, I should take care of that so that I am provided with a optimal fuel efficiency. And of course, discussions are undergoing to provide tire labeling so that once you change your tires after the original fitment tires are about to change, so you have a choice to go with the higher rating tires. Then you have a lot of testing facilities to test tires. These tires are testing on a rolling platform, and you can test these tires up to a speed of 350 kilometers per hour, and of course with various load ratings. And such facilities are available in Air and other test facilities available across the country. And then of course, not just the rolling resistance, the tire has to meet the strength requirements also. So those tests are also conducted on the tire and the tire material. As you would have noticed that when you are running on highways, national highways or expressways, the maximum noise that you are hearing is because of the tire noise. The vehicle is very quiet. You're not hearing the noise outside. The maximum noise that you hear is of the tire noise. So extensive work is going on in the tire noise area. So such test is done on the wheel. Here you would see a road surface. There is a big roller actually below this. This moves and it is inside a semi-anechoic room. I'll just show you that semi-anechoic room in one of my slides later. And these tests are done for research purposes to improve the tire tread design to reduce the noise. That is why you'll find there's these tire tread patterns vary from tire manufacturer to manufacturer. They do a lot of research work to optimize these tread patterns to provide optimum rolling noise as well as tire safety. Lighting again. There are a lot of tests which are done on automotive headlamp and the rear lights that you see on a vehicle. And these are tests done on in the lab in a dark room. The instrument called goniometer. So a lot of testing is undertaken by testing laboratories in the dark room using this goniometer. I'll share these links. And these are very important tests because automotive lighting is a active safety device. So it's a very important factor when you are driving the vehicle at night, and lighting plays a very important role in the safety of the vehicle. Unfortunately, again, I can't play these videos. But I would encourage you to watch these videos, and probably you will appreciate the fact that how much, you know, effort is taken by the testing agencies as well as the manufacturers to come up with a beautiful product on the road, and how you can take advantage of these technologies when you are riding these vehicles yourself. Then there is a term called accelerated vehicle testing. Nowadays, you know that automotive manufacturers, not just in automotive area, in any area for that matter, the product has to be introduced in the market as soon as possible. And the development time, which was earlier 5 years, then it came to 3 years. And now for a new automotive automotive manufacturer to introduce a new vehicle in the market, it takes around 18 months. To reduce that time of that product testing, and how that is done in the laboratory. So there is a instrument called four poster testing or a two-wheeler poster testing for two-wheelers. So you run the vehicle on road for certain kilometers, you acquire the data using accelerometers and strain gauges. Once that data is acquired, so you develop your own program, you run your program in the lab, you mount your vehicle on those four posters, and that four posters give the drive to those vehicles, and the strength and the durability part of the vehicle is tested using this accelerated vehicle testing program. You would have noticed that any vehicle that is available in the market today comes with certain warranty. So those warranties are decided by the vehicle manufacturers by using such types of testing called accelerated vehicle testing. So these are very interesting videos. These you may please refer to when the link is. Coming to electric vehicles, so electric vehicles have become very popular in India today. And in India, from long, we have had standards for electric vehicles. I mean, for decades now, we have standards for electric vehicles. It's just that the technology for lithium-ion battery is a little expensive, and probably you don't find products which are available across the range for the consumer. But the technology is available with all the manufacturers, and they are coming up with products which the customers can use. However, if you talk about passenger vehicles, yes, the vehicles are very expensive. But if you talk about two-wheelers, there are a lot of affordable electric two-wheelers which are now available today, which are approved by testing agencies, and which you can buy to save on fuel. There is another thing called electromagnetic compatibility. A lot of electronics go into today's vehicle, but when you know that when electronics involved, so you have to avoid the interference which can be caused by various radiations that are available in the environment. You don't want your vehicle to malfunction. You don't want the different components of your vehicle which are electronically controlled to malfunction. So we conduct a test called electromagnetic compatibility. Standards are available, and this is a test setup. So the vehicle is tested in this anechoic chamber for various electromagnetic compatibility. Noise. So we have talked about lot about testing. So there are some tests which are exclusively done for research purposes. So noise as a mandatory test, it is done only as a, you know, just to test a pass-by noise that the vehicle is running at a certain speed, and you test the vehicle noise from a certain distance. So that's the only vehicle noise test you do as a mandatory requirement. But as a quality, there is a lot of work that goes behind, and you will find that the vehicle sound quality varies from vehicle to vehicle. And that is where you have different class of vehicle. You may have a vehicle at the bottom of the pyramid, which has all the safety requirement, which has all the emission requirements, but may not meet the noise characteristic which you may find at a in a high end vehicle. So what goes on in those sort of vehicles is a lot of research in the acoustic materials, in the acoustic designing of these panels, of the doors, the trims, the sunroofs. A lot of research goes on in those fields. And of course, you have intake and exhaust noise, which has to be controlled and monitored. A lot of development is happening in acoustic material development. So material is not just for the, it's like steel or anything like that. So you have a lot of acoustic materials. So whenever you sit in a car, so you will find that there is a, at the below your feet, you will find a lot of material there. So those are all serving as acoustic barriers so that the noise from the engine is not transmitted inside the cabin. So a lot of research goes on in those areas. Also, you would have find that earlier you used to have open gensets and now you have closed gensets. So what makes those closed gensets make less noise is that these closed gensets is filled with these acoustic materials which absorb the sound, and these gensets make less noise to what they used to make earlier. The engine is the same, but it emits less noise to the environment and therefore helping the system. When we talk of research, so obviously when you do research in a certain area, that research expertise is extended to different areas as well. So whatever we do for noise in automotive area, so we extend that expertise to products such as washing machine, condensing unit, refrigerators, and the chimneys that is available in your kitchen, then noise barriers that are available, along the highways, and these glass. So these are a lot of used, extensively used in the building material and making those buildings. So a lot of research that has gone into making an automotive product quieter is also going, that expertise is also going into making these products quieter. Coming to simulations. So as I said, that product development time has significantly reduced and it has roughly come to around 18 months. What helps an engineer to reduce that time is obviously using those accelerated test methods, and significantly the tools that are available in market today are simulation tools. So we have tools for crash simulation, durability simulations, noise simulations, then flow dynamics, multi-body dynamics, then for processes. So these software tools are available by different software manufacturers. You use these tools to arrive at a solution quickly and arrive at an optimum product. And that product only you manufacture and test so that the testing time gets significantly reduced. So as a budding automotive engineers, this field is very lucrative, So when you enter a automotive domain, so you find this field very interesting. But let me remind you, these are just the tools and they are not godfathers that they will give the solution instantly. So you have to feed the right information, get the right result. What my advice to automotive engineers is that you use these tools as, to reduce your time, but you have to significantly work on the basics. You have to significantly work on your testing methods to arrive at the best product which can meet the customer requirement. I'll talk something about courses that are run by ERA. So I have finished with my testing and research work. So I'll talk about some of the courses that are run by ERA. Probably it would be interest to you and the engineers. So ERA works extensively with universities such as BIT, that is Bangalore Technology, Veltech in Chennai, Rice Technology, then University of Alabama, and Tennessee Technical University. So ERA runs a lot of NTEC and PhD programs. After BE, you can enroll in these programs. And in these programs, 1 year, you are supposed to spend in these institutes and one you are spending at the area where you learn these specialized courses. So unfortunately in India, there are not many automotive courses which are available to the automotive engineers. And some of the domains that I touched, like noise, the crash, brake testing, these are unfortunately unavailable as your academics when you are doing your BE. So these are available as part of specialized courses. So these are some of the courses where you can go through these. So these are some of the specialized courses available. I'll come to questions. If there are any questions, I can take those questions now.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your such an incredible knowledge with us. We have a lot of questions in the chat box right now. We will take the queries one by one. So the first question we have is by Ms. Pooja, student BMIAT.
Yes, please.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Pooja Panchal from BMIT, third year mechanical branch. So my question is, we know we are facing same situation as Great Depression in terms of GDP growth and much more. And our country is facing financial crisis for so long. So what do you think, what impact of COVID-19 on automotive value chain?
Definitely, automotive industry is a manufacturing-based industry. So when we talk of COVID-19 situation, definitely, as you know, that there is a lot of restriction in the attendance of the employees that those are able to go to a company. And it will have a deep impact, definitely, on the output of the manufacturing companies. That is the first part. And second, obviously, the products that are getting manufactured, then the resale, then the sale part is also getting affected. Because the people are not venturing out. And obviously, when you want to make a choice, you know, you want to go for buying a vehicle, you want to do a lot of research, you want to do a lot of trials. So obviously, people are not venturing out. So it will definitely have a good impact. Good impact in the sense, a negative impact on the automotive industry. But I'm sure, as any other industry, automotive industry will face it boldly and will come out of it soon. Let's hope so.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Mr. Akash, student BMIAT.
What question? Do you think will be the impact of additive manufacturing on the coming future of automotive industry in the testing and compact
purpose? Hey, Akash, I could not hear you properly. There is some disturbance.
Gosh, there is some disturbance.
Sir, what is the impact of additive manufacturing, that is 3D printing, sir, in the coming future in automotive industry in the component testing phase? Sir, like 3D printed chassis, sir, unko kaise test karenge?
As you know, rapid prototyping is already getting used in automotive industry. We make products, we design products, and some of those products are then, you know, through these rapid prototyping methods are getting manufactured, and as an initial product, they are getting used for, you know, initial tests and trials. And obviously not just for trials, so once you develop a product and you want to see it, how it is getting shaped, so such technologies are extensively used even today and already been used by automotive.
Thank you, sir.
Now
I request Pawan, student BMIAT, to please put up your question.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir Pawan Devakar, final year mechanical student. Sir, my question is, the world of AI and automation, what skill do I need to be a better employable engineer in automotive industry? Hello?
Hello, yes, please.
Hello.
Please repeat your question,
Devan. Yes. Okay, sir. Sir, my question is, the world of AI and automation, what skill do I need to be a better employable engineer in automation industry? Hello.
Yes, I will take advantage of this question to share an important update with you. Under UN Nations program, there is a lot of development that is going on to develop autonomous vehicles. So now, this automotive industry is no more a mechanical domain industry. You know, it involves every engineer that you can think of, okay, electronics, electrical. And it's a combined effort of all engineers. So what I would suggest as a mechanical engineer to is to concentrate on your basics. They will never go. I mean, the brakes will always remain. Okay, the engine will be always there. And obviously, when you are part of an industry, so you get to know a lot of electronics features. As I mentioned earlier, that as a academic domain, at this point of time, especially in India, we are not enlightened with such knowledge at academic level. But when you join a company, and obviously through research and through participating in different groups, you get to know that how to work on those domains. And as far as electronics engineers are concerned, that whatever you learn in your subject like communication, so that is very important when you talk about automotive, because there are a lot of sensors involved. And those sensors talking with different sensors, what sort of frequency and all, those play a lot of important role. So, and each and every engineer, each and every domain, just work on your basics. That is very important today. The basics have to be very perfect, whether you belong to mechanical or electronics, and don't worry about the other one. You'll still be still be employed. Basics should be perfect.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Another question is from Mr. Abhinav, student, BMIET.
Can we hear from you, Abhinav? I think Jania is not responsive. So I
can take next one.
Another question is from Ms. Shreya, student, BMIET.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Shreya, final year student of BMIET. My question is, what are the main direction of development for electromobility in energy crisis scenario?
Sorry, could you speak please louder?
So my question is, what are the main direction for development of electromobility in energy crisis scenario?
Electromobility by you mean electric vehicles?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
If I have understood correctly, so we are talking about electric mobility. A lot of research work is going on in electric mobility. And in fact, in last 2 or 3 years, a lot of startups have come up, and they have come up with their own products, developing two-wheelers especially, two-wheeler electric vehicles. And India, as a country, you know, we are far ahead. We have this technology available. Unfortunately, the major part that is missing is that's the battery technology. And we have to do a lot of work in battery technology as far as country is concerned. But as a automotive industry, it is available around the globe to take use of. And probably in years to come, you will find a significant portion of electric vehicles in the market. They may not replace gasoline engines absolutely in near future, I believe. And but they will have their good share in the automotive.
Thank you, sir. So now I request our Dean Academics, Dr. Vishal Jain. So would you like to say something?
Yeah, sure. Vikram, there is one question which has come onto the Facebook. Viewer want to ask a question.
Yes, please.
He asked, is it possible or cost effective to have only CNG based engines in India?
Let me When we talk about self-reliance in fuel, so you have to then consider all types of fuel. Yes, CNG is there, obviously. But when we talk of CNG technology, then obviously the other vehicle parameters are getting affected, like vehicle performance, power performance. Then when all sorts of different technologies are available, then as a customer, you are interested in, you know, trying different technologies. So you definitely cannot mandate any technology per se, but yes, you encourage to use alternate fuels. Like, for example, wherever possible, like in road transport and wherever there is a control of the government, so there they mandate that, okay, only CNG buses are running. But as a customer, like as a passenger vehicle, I may have my own choice. I may not want a CNG vehicle for myself. I want a petrol vehicle. I want a diesel vehicle.
True.
So probably you cannot make that binding on the customer.
Thank you, Vikram. We have some very senior academicians watching you live, Vikram. To mention one, we have a very senior professor, Professor R.K. Soni from Deen Bandhu Chhoturam University of Science and Technology, is watching you live. He is here in Zoom itself. The another one is a very senior person, Mr. Arun Kumar Day. He is a principal of Hindu Indian College. He is also watching live here. So I request Professor Soni, if you would like to ask anything. I am unmuting you, sir. If you would like to ask anything from Vikram.
Okay, Vikram, it's very nice to listen to you, and you have a lot of work in your institute. And I'm also associated with the automobile from the last 20 years. I taught automobile engineering. I have exposure for as a judge for a Baha at Indore.
Oh,
yes. We are your senior, and director was, we worked together in the team. So my concern is we are sufficient, and prepared world class technology, but we are not able to create a employment for our students. Particular from my private institutes, they are doing under employed jobs. So what is the future of employment as a automobile engineers? Have you some insight? Another question is, you have work and ARI working on internal combustion engine automobile. What future is electrical? Only four motors at a four wheels and one controller. Everything will be eliminated. Your differential will be out, your gearbox will be out, your clutch will be out, your brakes will be out. Only four electric motors and one controller, which can work for a differential, for a torque variation, for a absorption of braking energy. And that is a futuristic, I think it's my vision, ki vehicle should be like that. We should eliminate very heavy components. Are you your ARI working on electrical future vehicles or not? Like General Motors, one of my counterpart, I am from Thapar. He is working in General Motors in America, and they are secretly working on such of automobiles. So what about the scene in India? How many years it will take? God knows. So that is only a discussion point of view. I'm not getting any proper answer or not. It's only discussions. Okay. That we must think how to give employment to our engineers. It's our moral responsibility as a teachers, and a social responsibility, and parents' responsibility. When they will work in India, Indian industries, they should not go here and there and do a petty jobs. And because automobile sector is the very biggest employment creators. So biggest industries, I think.
Yes, in India, obviously, automotive manufacturing jobs, the automotive industry per se provides the most manufacturing jobs that are available in India. Earlier, only manufacturing, but now we have very research centers also, many research centers of the global manufacturers that have come into it. which not just the manufacturing jobs, but we have design jobs as well. But obviously, you know, as we all know, the fact that a lot of engineering colleges have come up in India of late, and obviously there is a lot of competition. And as we know now that we are going through this phase of COVID-19, is having an impact on the automotive industry as well. And obviously it will have an impact on the employability from the industry. But from the student point of view, I would definitely would like to highlight that students should not get, you know, disheartened. And all types of, you know, opportunities are available to you also. Not that just the people from IITs get jobs. I am also from a very, what you can say, a private engineering college. Then I did my master's. So what I would say that students should always strive to, you know, add value to his
skills.
Resume, as you can be, skills, and how you can do that while the students who are there in the third year and also in the fourth year, probably you can learn some languages, foreign languages, and you know that the major automotive hubs is Japanese, German, France. So you can, you know, learn languages to make yourself more employable. And then obviously looking for certain specialized courses where, like I mentioned, some of the courses which are run by ARI along with different agencies, different institutes. There are courses run by not only in India, but abroad also, in Germany as well as in USA, where they run programs specifically for automotive engineers. So that's a very good opportunity. And one should not just stop at B. That is what I would tell all the engineers, that you should just enhance your skills by at least going a step further, at least do your post-graduation part. Because while doing your post-graduation, you do extensive project work where you are getting accustomed to the real product. And there you get a lot of chance to, you know, work in the real domain. So that gives you a good opportunity. So don't stop at just a B. Please do a master's. So that adds value. And while doing master's, look out for such specialized courses that will help you. That is one of the advice that I can give.
Now, naturally, we have to be, our students has to be very alert, and there has to be keep them ready for a job market. Otherwise, simple B.Tech in electronics or in mechanical is hardly matters. Until now, you have a work on a, some project where a lot of latest skills work is required. Of course, automobile is very attractive, and people are very attracted to this field. I have also recommended 5 or 6 students. They are doing higher studies in Germany. Germany is very liberal to get an Indian student. So my advice to the students is ki whether you are electronics, control, communication, you must prepare yourself according to your interest and according to your capability and skills. Everybody can't be good in software. They may be a hardware. They can go for a welding technology. They can go for a CNC machinery, or they can go for a robotics. Everything is there in the automobile industry. So don't be disheartened, and keep and enhance your knowledge, which can be a benefit for your employment. But you have to catch your job your own. Otherwise, no agency is going to be. You must be prepared for a any examination, entry in Maruti or in Honda or any other industries. You must watch. That is advice to our students, what we can do. What effect of COVID, that is a worldwide, and we should not be disheartened, and we should enjoy that time and period. You can enjoy your hobbies. You can do some gardening. You can improve your health. You can make your muscles. Okay, you can read some literature on Vivekananda. That is a good time. God has given you that holidays. You don't waste it, and you enjoy in your own way. What at least you must contribute for yourself and for the society. That is my message. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Soni. Thank you very much. Vikram, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
I told you we have a very senior person again, Dr. Arun Kumar Ray from Hindu College of Engineering. I am unmuting you, sir, if you would like to ask anything.
Overall good, sir.
Hello, good afternoon.
Good to see you, sir.
हाँ जी. मेरे अकॉर्डिंग तो जो आपका वेबिनार था बेटर था. हम अपने स्टूडेंट्स को भी पहले से पता होता तो मैं स्टूडेंट्स को भी कहता शेयर करने के लिए आपके साथ, मगर मेरे को पहले से आइडिया नहीं था. हेमंत जी का फोन मेरे पास आया, फिर मैंने कहा कि चलिए. और कुछ कॉलेज के वर्क होते हैं जिसकी वजह से मैं पूरा पार्टिसिपेट नहीं कर पाया. बाकी मेरे को बहुत अच्छा लगा आपका ये
सर.
और इस टाइम पे कोविड की वजह से ऐसा है कि बच्चे वगैरह सारे जो है हम सेफ्टी को देख के कंसीडर कर रहे हैं कि अपनी सेफ्टी और उनकी सेफ्टी, बच्चों की सेफ्टी भी. तो सोनी सर ने कहा बहुत अच्छा लगा कि अपनी हेल्थ बनाइए, मसल्स बनाइए, गार्डनिंग करिए, जो भी आपकी हॉबी है उसको फ्रूटफुल करिए, उसको पूरी करिए. जो टाइम मिला हुआ है हमें, एंजॉय का टाइम मिला हुआ है इस टाइम पे
जी,
तो वाकई बहुत अच्छा था बच्चों के लिए. खासतौर से मैं मैकेनिकल फाइनल ईयर के स्टूडेंट्स की बात करूं तो उनके लिए भी बेनिफिशियल.
आई विल शेयर द दिस एंटायर सेमिनार, द वेबिनार इज बीइंग रिकॉर्डेड ऑन द वेब. आई विल शेयर यू द लिंक एंड द लिंक विक्रम हैज he was about to show us but unfortunately could not show some very okay. YouTube videos are there. I'll send you across. I'll send to your office and you can probably give
okay,
it
okay,
to
okay. Welcome.
Thank you sir.
Thank you.
Okay.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you. I have one question directly from one Mr. Manav Khera. I think he's your student or something.
Just a second. Yes. Manav Khera, I'm unmuting him. Yes. Manav, I am unmuting you.
Hello, sir. Hello.
I think you have asked that how to apply for ARN.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. For the benefit of all, ARN actually, since I already told you that ARN has different, you know, programs running the different colleges. So some of the training engineers we are directly running those courses.
Sir, is there any kind of test or something so that I can directly apply for ARI after my BTech, or it's just a college placement?
No, it's just placement. There is no all India level test. So
okay,
some of the placement is done through those colleges. And secondly, ARI keeps updating its website for the various requirements. So it's not necessarily that the requirement is for a experienced person. That requirement may be for a fresher also, because ARI always keep on taking a different research projects. So in those research projects, some active hands are also required. So in
yes,
those times, some freshers are also taken. So please, I would request you to follow ARI on LinkedIn as well as ARI website continuously. So under the careers page and on the LinkedIn page, various members of ARI keep posting the requirements, and I'm not sure if that position still exists, but some time back there was a posting on LinkedIn where some freshers were required in Chennai for some ARI project. You can just do some Google search for that LinkedIn update if that position is full or that position is.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now, it is the time to mark the ending of such an informative session. Thank you so much all for being such a great and supportive audience. And special thanks to our guest, Mr. Vikram Tandon. I hope to see you all in the next webinar. Thank you all for joining us today.
Jania, at the outset, let me formally thank Vikram to join us. Just on a mere request, he took out so much time, since last 2-3 weeks, he was busy preparing the slides. And he spoke on the topic, which we don't often hear about this topic, that is the automobile industry. It looks very nice from outside. We drive the car, we sit in car, but so much technical aspects are involved. This, I'm sure that all the students who have joined us are viewing us here on Facebook as well. They got some insight of the automobile industry. Thank you so much, Vikram. And hope to see you and hear from you the coming days as well. Thank you very much.
And just to close from my side, so I will be sharing those YouTube links to you, and also I'll be sharing my personal email ID, so which you can send to your students. They can contact me anytime with their queries. I will try to help them as much as possible.
Thank you so much, Vikram.
Okay, thank you. Bye bye. Good luck to everyone.